Good morning. Can you hear me, Lancaster, Loughborough, Birmingham? Do you see a presentation on PDF file? And there is also visualizer. Yeah, okay. Thank you. So we are coming back to the Heisenberg group and certain properties related to its representations. So I already explained that that course does not contain essentially new material. Rather, I am trying to organize better information which is already available and make certain particular logical order for that information. And revising material for this lecture, I find out what is probably better to make further reshape of the course from previous years. In particular, I find out what the Siegel-Barman representation shall be introduced, and Siegel-Barman space shall be introduced earlier. And we will be able to make a proof for the Sturm-von-Neumann theorem more efficient and transparent. So now the PDF files on the magic course are changed according to that new approach. And here is one addition related to the Fourier transform, for example. So in particular, we introduce the Fourier transform as the intertwining operator between Schrödinger representation and Schrödinger representation composed with the automorphism of the Heisenberg group, automorphism I, which is given by that formula. And it's easy to verify what if we apply I twice, we will simply change signs of component X and Y, leaving them in place. And essentially that means that intertwining operator with the square of I will be simply the reflection on the domain. So that's the function fx to the function minus x. And from this identity, very easy to obtain known formula for the inverse of the wavelet transform. Inverse of the wavelet transform will be the composition of Fourier transform itself with this reversion in the domain. And so as we see, even such a property of Fourier transform can follow from the structure of the Heisenberg group. And we will need invertibility of the Fourier transform further down today when we study the von Neumann theorem. So again, another properties which we studied was Gaussian is the fixed vector for the Fourier transform, and we also proven almost demonstrated based on the group representation the isometry of the Fourier transform, that is Clausius identity for L2 spaces, and physical consequence of that would be that we may, by means of Fourier transform, swap the representation of quantum mechanics where wave function give probability of coordinates into wave function give probabilities distribution for momentum. Now, we are knowing the special role of the Gaussian and the Schrödinger representation, we build the corresponding wavelet transform as we described in general terms and general condition. That will be just the matrix coefficient, say, in terms of group representation related to the Schrödinger representation. So we apply and induce the covariant transform. We apply the representation to the Gaussian and then take in a product with the given wave function f. So the representation applied to the Gaussian produce such a kernel. And according to the general result, which we had before, that will be the intertwining operator between the Schrödinger representation rho and action on the corresponding space of function defined on the plane, which we calculated before as a case of the induced representation over L2, R2. And in particular, it's an easy exercise to verify what would be the corresponding infinitesimal generators for that representation. And we remember that the infinitesimal generator for vector field X in the Schrödinger picture was corresponding to the observables of coordinate. So in new model, that would be the operator, then corresponding operator, infinitesimal generator, would be also representing the coordinate in that Fox-Siegel-Barman picture. And correspondingly, the infinitesimal generator for vector field Y would be the representing operator for the observables of momentum. And again, it's just a direct calculation to see what we don't miscalculate anything. We check what a commutator of two vector fields would be corresponding to the infinitesimal generator of the set S. So the algebra, very algebra commutation relation, or Heisenberg commutation relation, just verify it once more as a tool to check what our formulas are correct. Now we may use again a certain consequences of previous theory related to the analyticity. As we discussed before, Gaussian is the vector which minimizes uncertainty for the coordinates and momentum. So to do that, it has to be a null solution of this differential operator on the real line. And then correspondingly, image of the Gaussian, image of corresponding wavelet transform, Fox-Siegel-Barman transform, will be consisting of functions which are no solution to the such differential operator on the plane. So this is explicit formula which follows from the previous calculation of infinitesimal generators. So as you can see, the principal role here is played by derivative with respect to Z, complex derivative, and we have also a multiplication by the complex variable Z bar. Here is, we need to discuss some technical aspects. So there are essentially two ways how we may write down the situation with the Fox-Siegel-Barman space. So in a product on this space, if we consider functions F1 and F2 obtained on the Heisenberg, on the Fox-Siegel-Barman space, will be defined by integration over the complex plane for the F1, F2, Z times E minus 5 over 2 Z, Z bar, DZ, DZ bar, where this is the usual Debye measure on R2, which we may think as just C, collection of all complex numbers. So question is how to treat, I probably don't need that file or two here. So problem is how to treat that factor which appears in that situation, in that expression. So you may either introduce new measure, d mu Z, which include Gaussian. So it will be minus pi Z, Z bar, dz, dz bar. And then you integrate n. So this is what for the discussion above. And similarly, because we discuss unitarity of the transformation, so cross product of two copies of L2 on the real line will be sent to L2 space on the plane. And furthermore, we get very important formula which tell us that inner product on that unitarity, so inner product of two functions on the plane, can be really by means of Fourier-Wibner transform reduced to the product of two inner products, function f1 times f2 and phi1 times phi2. So this is very important property formula, isometrical formula, which we will use on many occasions today and later in our lecture. So that isometry we will remember and proceed to the next result, which explain what is a relation between covariant and contravariant transform related to a certain mother wavelet on the Schrödinger representation. So according to the previous formula, composition of invariant covariant transform and contravariant transform will be identity operator times the inner product of two function which was used for the analysis, mother wavelet which was used in covariant transform, and mother wavelet phi, which was used for the contravariant transform. So this is the formula. Of course, that inner product can be zero if our choice is not compatible. If our two vectors are orthogonal, then composition is of two transformation vanish. But if we are careful, if we choose this function not to be orthogonal, in particular, we may take the same function, non-zero function, for analysis and reconstruction, when that inner product, of course, will be equal to the normal function, then we will get identity operator. So formula is very straightforward. Calculation is very straightforward with this formula. So to see just for arbitrary function f and g, we build the corresponding expression here, a composition of contravariant and covariant transform to f in the product with g. Substitute the definition of these maps from the previous slides. Then change the order of integration and inner product. Inner product, of course, given by certain integration here, but and that can be done by the Fubini theorem, at least for L1 functions. So inner product appears inside. You produce just another copy of the covariant transform of function G with the mother wavelet psi. Then we will end up with the inner product of two wavelet transforms, which according to the previous formula is a product of two inner products. So that essentially gives us that we have inner product of F times G with that factor. Because this has happened for any choice of F and G, so composition of covariant and contravariant operator shall be identity times this factor. So this is the notation of that result. Now we may follow up and present the proof what happened with the twisted convolution. So twisted convolution, I recall the definition of twisted convolution with respect to certain representation was as follows. So we take the representation for certain kernel K1, that would be the operator on our space, and multiply to the operator which corresponds to the representation of another kernel K2, that would be correspond to the representation of our twisted convolution for kernels K1 and K2. This was the definition of twisted convolution. So let's see why this formula is true here. So twisted, what is essentially it told us? So if I analyze a function F1 by means of mother wavelet phi1 and twist and convolve it with the signal F2 analyzed with the mother wavelet phi2, result will be function F1, signal F1, analyzed with the mother wavelet phi2 times that factor, which is the cross factor between a signal F2 and the analyzing mother wavelet phi1. So again, we start from the expression for the twisted convolution. So we just denote by F capital 1 and 2 corresponding wavelet transform. When rho from the twisted convolution representation will correspond to the product of operators generated by F1 and F2. Now, if we will come back to the definition of the covariant, contravariant transform, the second factor here is the contravariant transform applied to the vector, which is the F2. In other words, this is the wavelet transform of F2, small. But composition of contravariant transform and covariant transform, this is identity with certain factor. So we put function F2 with this factor. Factor, of course, may go for a linear operator in front of this linear operator. So we are now repeating once more the previous sequence of calculations. So rho F1 applied to F2, that is again composition of the contravariant and covariant transform. So that will be identity for F1 times that factor. Now we put things, roll things in the opposite way. We pick up F1 with the corresponding factor, which is the first factor here, as the result of application contravariant transform to covariant transform with G and phi2. And that will be just that expression, which gives us the right hand side of equation 68. In this case, so we have proven our formula. If it's applied for this is operator formula, it's applied for a certain vector G in L2 space. Since G was arbitrary, so that operator identity is true in general. So that is a demonstration for our proposition. So a twisted convolution here, indeed, somehow twist the analyzing vector and signals. So if you will compare where is phi1, phi2 is going to in that formula, so it's again here happen a twist in certain positions. Now we apply the above result to our special function, which is Gaussian, Gaussian which has many special properties. So we apply the wavelet transform to the Gaussian, and mother wavelet is Gaussian itself. So this is a really matrix coefficient calculated on the Gaussians. So again, maybe worth to put it here. So wavelet transform phi pi, that will be 5 times p, or our representation rho, d pi. So this is expression for that function which we are calculating. That function is defined on the plane as we are considering the left regular representation. So we also introduce the shift of the function which is the image of the Gaussian underwave transform by on the left by parameters AB in the Heisenberg group. So rather on corresponding homogeneous space. So direct calculation with Fourier transform and Schrödinger representation shows what phi capital is given by this formula. So really to write down the Schrödinger representation reduce our calculation to the simple result. So image of the Gaussian is looking again like a Gaussian, but now it's in two variables. Initial Gaussian was with respect to variable Q, single very real variable. Now we have the components x, y on corresponding homogeneous space. Then it's easy to see what happened with the under left shift with the Gaussian. We simply apply a formula which after on the corresponding homogeneous space, that is a Gaussian with the shifted mean expectation. So Gaussian, again, Gaussian is like a path given certain expectation at point zero. So here applying corresponding shift, we put expectation value from zero to AB, point AB. Now, there are two last formulas. You may, if you will analyze them slightly, you will see that rho applied to the last term here. So rho AB applied to the image of the Gaussian by applying property of the Weyl transform, that will be shifted Gaussian, so it will be phi AB. So in composition of rho of phi will be just that corresponding twisted convolution. So that is really the third formula is another way to write the fourth one. But fourth one is simply a pull from previous corollary which we have for the twisted convolution. So twisted convolution of two wavelet transform, and this is wavelet transform, will be the wavelet transform of the second function with the first mother wavelet. And that is the result which presented here on the right hand side. So that is certain calculation which shows what particular application of previous formulas for the Gaussian. And now we are ready to demonstrate the Stone-Neumann theorem, which essentially claim in physical language. It's interpreted openly with theorem. It's saying what any model of quantum mechanics is unitary equivalent to the Schrödinger model. So that is standard presentation, and history of that theorem is exactly reflect that situation. In 20th of 20th century, two form of quantum mechanics was developed. It was a Schrödinger form, where it was a Schrödinger equation, and the function was considered, and quantum mechanics was represented by wave functions on the real line, evolving under Schrödinger equation. It was one form, and it was in good agreement with experiments done on that time. And was the second picture of quantum mechanics, so-called Heisenberg picture, where observables was represented by infinite dimensional matrices. And because the mathematical object used in two pictures was so different, so it was either differential equation on L2 function or infinite dimensional matrices, so for a long time people was puzzled, is there any significant difference between two models? And then come Stone von Neumann theorem, which essentially built explicit isomorphism between two models, and that told us that as soon as you have the standard presentation for Heisenberg commutation relation, so if you and both Schrödinger model and Heisenberg infinite matrices model does present Heisenberg commutation relation, then corresponding models of quantum mechanics are equivalent with the unitary operator sending one model to another. And then it was at that time it was very important, it was reconciled to approaches to quantum mechanics, and all other forms of quantum mechanics, for example, based on the phase space functions and Moyle bracket and other things, they from the beginning is known to be equivalent to the Schrödinger or Heisenberg model. And then correspondingly, we do not expect from these models any differences in their conclusion. But of course, that does not tell what models are completely identical. So certain models are more convenient, and for many reasons, people believe with the Hoeksiegel-Barman model is more convenient to model. For example, image of function, wave function in Hoeksiegel-Barman model, as we know, analytic. So analytic function possess quite a lot of nice properties. We may analyze and decompose them in terms of Taylor series or other things. So that make our technique is more elaborated. So that doesn't mean what we all need to reduce entire quantum mechanics just to single model. Usually it's helpful to have several models in hand, and under such situation it's useful to know what these models are really equivalent. So let's go to the Stone von Neumann theorem. Essentially here is the formal statement, but practically it tells us that if we have some unitary representation, then we can decompose it into unitary irreducible sub-representations, and every component in this decomposition, any irreducible unitary representation of the Heisenberg group, is equivalent to the Hoeksiegel-Barman one. So not to the Schrödinger, as it will follow from the proof, but Hoeksiegel-Barman representation will be our model one, which will construct the isomorphism. And what is good about that theorem? So essentially, it's provide explicit construction of this operator, and that operator, the environment operator, which is constructed here as it, in that theorem, in this proof, is essentially the contravariant transform. So that somehow make a logical order for our previous study, why we spent so many times studying the group representation, Hoeksiegel-Barman model. So we are now are helpful to demonstrate that result. And idea of the proof is as follows, because Gaussian is very special function, and essentially it's a unique solution of certain operator. As you remember, Gaussian was the solution to e to the minus pi x squared over 2, if I remember correctly, was solution of when differential operator of the type dx plus pi x, something like that. So it equation of this type, which solution solve, and this is essentially is rho of vector field x plus e rho of vector field y applied to Gaussian and if x and y are given to satisfy the Heisenberg commutation relation, then essentially it's uniquely determined its solution of this equation. So this is idea behind the proof. So Gaussian, as soon as we have the commutative relation represented in our for Heisenberg group, then we can identify the function which serve like a Gaussian in this model. And as soon as we know the Gaussian, any other function is just the position of shifted Gaussians. And so as long as we know what is Gaussian, we know what will be the shifted Gaussians. And then if we know how a given function decomposed over shifted Gaussians, we can map it to the Fock-Siegel-Barman model. This is idea, formal, well, not informal idea of the proof. Well, now let's go into the detail. So first of all, we given a representation of the Heisenberg group, we expanded as usual, integrated for L1 functions. So as we did before, and the claim is what such integrated representation is faithful. So that means zero can be obtained only as a result of integration of zero function. And coming back to the Fourier-Wigner formulas and things like that, we may write down integrated representation and see what it is essentially related to the Fourier transform. And since Fourier transform is an invertible operation, so it's demonstrated faithfulness of representation rho on L1. Next, let's, as before, phi capital will be Waverly transform of the Gaussian or the Gaussian in the Fock-Siegel-Barman space. Then by previous formulas, we know what the shifted Gaussian, and so adopting previous formulas, we know what shifted image of the shifted Gaussian will be the that expression. It's easy to see what the operator of generated by integration of our representation with the Gaussian behave according to that formula as a projection. Well, this operator is that operator itself. And really, we have here the collection of orthogonal projections which decompose our representation into certain irreducible components, because that representation preserves orthogonality. So we may decompose our representation to the irreducible components, and for simple irreducible components, it's very easy to build the unitary intertwining operator to the Fock-Siegel-Barman transform just by considering the corresponding covariant transform with the mother wavelet which correspond to the Gaussian. So function corresponding to the Gaussian, that is a function which obtained in this formula by application of vector. So this is the proof, how it's going for the Sturm von Neumann theorem. Probably it will be better to stop today here, because next time we will discuss other operators, their role in the representation of Heisenberg group, and how they correspond to certain model, elementary model of the harmonic oscillator in quantum mechanics. So that will be topic of the next lecture. Questions? All right, thank you very much for coming. Don't forget to mark your presence by attendance on this lecture. I hope to see you next week.